Welcome to Space News from the Electric Universe, brought to you by the Thunderbolts Project at thunderbolts.info.
Scientists working at the Lawrence Livermore National Laboratory are proposing a radical new theory about the nature of invisible, theoretical dark matter particles. The scientists have developed what they call a, quote, stealth dark matter model, which suggests that dark matter is composed of electrically charged particles, and which are bound by a mysterious, unknown force. The theorists are hoping to use the Large Hadron Collider to try and verify their model. A recent science news story describing this research states, dark matter is currently thought to be completely inert to electromagnetic radiation, so it would be remarkable to discover that it is in fact composed of electrically charged particles which have somehow managed to avoid detection. However, today in our discussion with physicist Eugene Bagashov, we take a step backwards to ask a more fundamental question. Why should anyone assume that dark matter actually exists?
First of all, we need to remember what was the actual reason for inventing dark matter in the first place and how the idea of it evolved in the last decades. The initial problem dates back to 1930s when astronomers like Jan Oort and Fritz Zwicky have discovered that there is something wrong with the motions of stars and other objects in galaxies. The problem was pretty simple. Newton's law states that the square of orbital velocity of an object should be proportional to the force that keeps it in its orbit. In gravitationally centered orbital mechanics, gravity is considered to be the only acting force, so here the velocity of a body should be proportional to the gravitating mass around which this body is revolving. Thus, the velocity of a star or molecular cloud or any other object that moves around the galactic center should be proportional to the mass of a galaxy itself. We're talking about the mass that lies inside the body's orbit. And the actual measurements of velocities made using Doppler effect have shown that they are too big. There is simply not enough mass on the other side of the equation. Mechanically speaking, the centrifugal force should have thrown these stars away long time ago with such orbital velocities, since there is not enough gravitational force to counteract it, to keep them in place. This became known as the galaxy rotation problem, or the missing mass problem. So to provide the necessary mass, Zwicky first proposed to take into account not only the luminous matter, such as stars and nebulae, the mass of which we might estimate to at least some degree of reliability, but also various non-luminous stuff, such as, I quote, cool and cold stars, macroscopic and microscopic solid bodies, and gases. It was in his articles that the term dark matter have appeared for the first time, at least to my knowledge. But as we can see, at least in this quote from 1937, it means just normal matter that simply doesn't shine so bright. Over the coming years, this idea that there should be some sort of invisible matter that might govern the behavior of normal observable matter grew stronger. It was further reinforced from the other side of the universe in terms of scale, and by that I mean the microworld and high-energy particle physics. Theoretical particle physics was in its bloom at that time, with more and more new particles discovered and theoretically proposed every year. So this way or another, it soon became a commonly shared idea that there might be some other, yet undiscovered, invisible substance or a set of some unusual particles that correspond to dark matter. By the time when the new observations of galactic behavior were made by Vera Rubin, Kent Ford, and others in 60s and 70s, this idea was already anchored in many people's minds, and one might say that not much has changed ever since. It was generally accepted that the lack of force equals lack of mass, and the latter was accounted for by the action of some yet unknown particles or fields or other quantum objects. For example, it was proposed that supersymmetric particles might be the answer to the problem. Supersymmetry, or SUSY, is a theory that proposes that every particle species should have a partner particle species that is described by other quantum statistics. This means that there should be an undiscovered fermion paired with each known boson, and vice versa, there should be an undiscovered boson per each known fermion. It is worth noting that none of these partner particles were discovered since the inception of the theory in 1966 and wide recognition in the early 70s. In general, modern physics recognizes four fundamental interactions: gravitational, electromagnetic, weak, and strong. The range of the latter two is limited by the size of an atomic nucleus, so they cannot make any difference at astrophysical distances. So we are left only with gravitation and electromagnetism here. And once again, since it is generally supposed that there is no charge separation and there are no electric currents in space, there is only gravitation left. And we're back in the same mousetrap with missing masses and mysterious behavior in violation of Newton's law. By the way, since I've mentioned fundamental interactions, in the second half of the 1980s, there also was a proposition that the so-called WIMPs, or weakly interacting massive particles, could be the main component of dark matter. So people tried to construct various types of dark matter particles, including the possibility for them to interact not only by means of gravity, but also through weak interaction. But again, that only gives us the ability to detect them when they hit our sensors, and it doesn't concern the ability to keep galaxies together, which is still considered to be due to gravitation. In this slide, one new article looks interesting. It states that, I quote, "dark matter may be composed of electrically charged particles." This is an interesting step forward because an electric charge is, by definition, an ability to interact electromagnetically. So in this sense, if dark matter has an electric charge, it is no longer dark and we actually can see it, although it might not emit a lot. One might say that thus we return to the original interpretation of this term proposed by Zwicky. Of course, that doesn't mean that the authors state that it is the electricity that governs the behavior of galaxies, but we're one step closer to this idea here. In fact, the authors state that these charged particles might then combine to form electrically neutral particles, which they refer to as stealth dark matter. Thus, they still keep to the standard gravitational scenario, ignoring the possible electromagnetic nature of galactic behavior. It seems like it would still take years for the scientific community to turn to plasma physics and electromagnetism as a significant part in this play. Although it should already be quite clear that instead of violating Occam's razor by inventing some 5 times more matter than there is, maybe it would be better to use the forces and interactions that we already are aware of with the matter that we can observe with reliability. With that being said, and for the sake of completeness, I also want to mention a couple of other options that are somewhat out of the field of mainstream science these days. In general, as I've already said, Newton's law contains not just gravitating mass, but a force, with this mass being only a part of the whole expression. The square of velocity should be proportional to the gravitational constant multiplied by mass around which the object is revolving, and inversely proportional to the distance between them. So if the velocity on the left side is too big, not only we can artificially enhance the mass through injection of dark matter, but we also can suppose that the gravitational constant is not constant. It might, for example, depend on masses or distances. So for big objects like galaxies, it would be different than in our solar system or on planet Earth. And we actually know that the gravitational constant is very hard to measure. Maybe that's because it is not actually constant. It also might be somehow governed by the electric forces, which is not far from the ideas of Wall Thornhill, if I am not mistaken. There are also attempts in rewriting the Newton's law itself. For example, there is so-called modified Newtonian dynamics, or MOND, developed in 1983 by Mordechai Milgram. While being quite successful in explaining the behavior of galaxies, it still faces significant problems on a slightly bigger scale, in galactic clusters. So in my opinion, the field of possibilities is quite broad here, and the idea of dark matter is not in any way more preferable than modifications of Newton's law or consideration of electromagnetic forces. The latter, however, may be somewhat more comfortable since it doesn't require any adjustments to what is considered today as fundamental laws. We just have to discard the hypothesis of charge neutrality in space and consider the actual work of electricity across vast cosmic distances.
For continuous updates on space news from the Electric Universe, stay tuned to thunderbolts.info.